We live in a very strange universe indeed. In some ways, it's a kind of illusion of what happens, an echo of the quantum world that underlies everything. We are tempted to think of things in terms of classical objects. When one picks up a glass and takes a drink from it, that is a classical interaction with an expected outcome. But on the quantum level, things are very different, and particles can exist in a superposition. In other words, all states at once, until observation or interaction collapses them. This is well proven. Quantum effects are used in electronics, and the infamous double-slit experiment shows particles in the act of behaving as waves or individual particles when under observation. This has led to some very far-reaching and very bizarre notions within quantum physics, including the question of whether the universe exists at all when it's not being observed, which it does. Even a particle in a superposition is still a particle, and interaction with inanimate classical objects causes it to choose a state. But hidden within the history of physics are some very interesting possibilities, but it really depends on which interpretation of quantum mechanics you go with. There are three major ones. The most widely accepted is actually the spookiest one. It's the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics. This involves the infamous Schrödinger's cat thought experiment, where when something is not being observed or interacted with, it's in a superposition. Think of it as getting fuzzy. Only when it's observed and essentially interacted with, it collapses into a state. All possible outcomes reduce down to one. If you just go with the Copenhagen interpretation, then weird things happen. One of these is a thought experiment proposed by physicist Eugene Wigner in 1961, sometimes known as Wigner's friend. Essentially, what happens here is a coin toss that establishes two different realities, calling observation itself into question. So say you're performing a coin toss in a glass-isolated booth, and you have a friend across the room watching you do it. If you apply the rules of quantum mechanics to observers and people holding coins, then the universe gets very weird indeed. So the coin you are tossing is in superposition, if it's both heads or tails before you toss it and you create an outcome. You see it as tails, but your isolated counterpart on the outside doesn't have access to that information. Therefore, they describe it as being neither heads nor tails, but in superposition. That gets into entanglement. One outcome affects the other. From this, you can do what's known as an interference experiment and determine the superposition of the system. This creates an issue. The end result is two different perceived realities. But the question is just a thought experiment. Humans are not quantum objects. But the real question is, could it be tested? Can measurements in quantum physics really be subjective to whoever is observing them? Because it calls the reliability of observation into question, something science depends absolutely on. These ideas were furthered by John Bell, known as the Bell inequality, which if it's violated, then you end up with two sets of facts from two different observers. More recent work, however, has shown that the Bell inequality can be violated, meaning that there really isn't any such thing as an objective reality. That's assuming several things, including that signals somehow can't travel faster than light, but we don't actually know if that's the case. We simply know that the universe seems to prevent the transfer of meaningful information faster than light. But it doesn't prevent the transfer of random information faster than light, which is spooky action at a distance. But does show on the quantum scale that what is seen as fact may not be the same to all observers. That said, under any normal conditions in which we as humans experience in the universe on a large scale, the facts are safe. Now, there are other interpretations to quantum mechanics. One of these is the many worlds interpretation, where there isn't really a superposition, but that all realities split off from each other, creating universes that cover all possible outcomes. An almost infinite number of parallel universes is cumbersome to say the least, but may be the case, and does have its adherence in the scientific community. The last possibility is that the weirdness of the Copenhagen interpretation is mitigated by something that keeps quantum effects on the quantum level, at least most of the time. In other words, the world of the big presents a situation where quantum effects somehow cancel out, but not always. In this case, you can occasionally, if you wait long enough, and we're talking more than the current age of the universe, quantum effects such as quantum non-locality could telescope up to the world of the large. That's bad news. That could mean that it's possible in the universe, if beyond highly unlikely, that one moment you could be sitting in your living room, and the next you have been teleported a billion light years away in deep space. Not good. But thankfully, it's so unbelievably unlikely that it only ever happens in infinitely lasting universes. But particles themselves are basically non-local. They do this all the time. But what we do see is that causality seems to rule the world of the large. One event leads to the next, and so on. And as the soft sci-fi, but quite good overall TV series Lost put it, what happened, happened. But that may not be the case. Cue in one Dr. John Archibald Wheeler. People often ask me regarding Event Horizon interviews, out of all the scientists that are no longer with us, which one would I want to interview the most? They often ask if it's Einstein, Enrico Fermi, or Carl Sagan. But in reality, it's Wheeler. Few in physics have come up with as many interesting and still unexplored ideas as he did. Wheeler asked a puzzling question. Maybe instead of a set past, the universe actually functions as a feedback loop that sets the past as it moves forward in time. In other words, our actions and that of the universe's humdrum day-to-day interactions are actually solidifying the past. That gets back to the double slit experiment, where photons can behave as waves or particles, depending on if they are being observed by detectors of whatever sort. Wheeler added something to this by taking it to a much grander scale, a double slit experiment involving most of the universe itself. And the implications are really strange. So imagine a very distant quasar, an energetic galaxy from the early days of the universe. It's distant in both space, but also time. You're seeing the light from it ostensibly billions of years after it left the object. It just took the light from it that long to get to you by crossing space at the speed of light. Now imagine a pair of foreground galaxies in front of that quasar causing gravitational lensing. You can see this effect in this now famous James Webb Space Telescope image. Gravitationally powerful objects can bend light sources around them as a lens, which is what's happening with our quasar. Incidentally, that we see this effect serves as yet another confirmation of general relativity. You are seeing Einstein's work in the distortion of this galaxy's appearance from our perspective. From another area of the universe, it would appear perfectly normal. So in Wheeler's experiment, the two foreground galaxies substitute in for the double slits in the original experiment, and the light from the quasar stands in for the laser. So this gives the two different paths needed for the standard double slit experiment. Though there are other ways to perform it. There are YouTube videos on how you can do it with a laser pointer and a strand of hair, should you wish to see at least part of one of the strangest aspects of the universe in your living room, instead of quantum tunneling to another star system. This means that photons from the quasar can follow two different paths to your eye, as in the classic experiment. When viewing the bent light from the quasar, the telescope becomes the detector. If they look at one of the foreground galaxies, or the other, they should in this case get the same result either way. But if you combine the two images using mirrors so they line up simultaneously, you'd see the standard interference pattern of the double slit experiment. If the quasar was faint enough, you'd have individual photons hitting the detector one at a time. Here's the strange thing. The result wouldn't change. You'd still see the interference pattern, which means that both photons acted as waves, passing through intergalactic space, and followed both paths simultaneously, even though the paths were separated by potentially millions of light years. And if that isn't enough of a problem, the choice on how the astronomers used the telescope to make the measurements and design their experiment weighs in here. Wheeler noted that this ultimately means that the measurements made in the present determine a photon's past, whether it travels one or both routes. Known as the delayed choice experiment, Wheeler's idea has actually been proven in the laboratory since the 1980s. This leads to a very strange universe indeed. Wheeler himself conjectured that we are incidences of the universe observing itself and ultimately building itself, and the whole of the universe is not yet finished and indeed may never be. The act of observation, whether done with our eyes or detectors, we select and force the definition of history on the quantum scale, and it's not really fully written. But you have to be careful here. Observation is a tricky word in this case. The potentials can also be brought about by classical matter of any type. But as far as particles go, the past does not solidify until something interacts with something. It could really be that our universe is made up partially of uninteractive particles in a quantum superposition, photons traveling the blackness of space from the days just after the Big Bang, with histories and outcomes that are not defined until they interact with something over 13 billion years after leaving their source. Somehow this may be related to other oddities in physics. A good example here is to look at the life of a photon. Traveling at the speed of light, again due to relativity, a photon does not experience time. To it, it gets emitted and it interacts simultaneously, even though from our perspective it may have taken billions of years to pass through immense amounts of space. Is it any wonder, then, that the history of a photon can only be written from its future, since past and future don't exist to it? In Wheeler's view, the past is not yet fixed. But I leave you with this. In physics, there is no now. The present doesn't exist, and there is only the past and the future. The present is some sort of human construct that can't be defined according to the theories or the mathematics. How the present is measured depends on where you're observing it from. But if that's the case, and Wheeler really was onto something, how does this all fit together if an observation in the now defines the history of a particle? We may never know. Thanks for listening. I'm futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, currently concerned for the welfare of the photons. Instantaneous existence isn't much of an existence, and their job looks hard. Just to provide some light in the universe, they have to travel at the very fastest possible speed. Talk about rushing around and stress. It really is a thankless job, especially compared to a proton sitting doing not much of anything in the nucleus of a boron atom. And be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.